Hello everyone, in this video we'll be discussing about the flow volume lobes found in different respiratory conditions localized to different anatomical location. So, a 60-year-old chronic smoker presented to the emergency with acute onset dyspnea and an inspiratory stridor. There was no associated dysphagia present. On examination, the body temperature was normal, the chest examination was normal, the local oral cavity and oropharynx examination was also normal. The laryngoscopy could not be done in emergency, but a previous pulmonary function test report was done for the was available with the patient, and it showed the following type of flow volume curve. So what is the probable site of the lesion and what can be the cause for this acute onset dyspnea? So whenever a problem like this comes to us, the first thing that we should always look for is which phase is being involved, which phase of respiration is getting affected. Like we can see that the patient has an inspiratory type of stridor, and in the flow volume curve also, like this is a normal curve with this being the end expiration, followed by this is the inspiratory loop, followed by this is the expiratory loop. So we have to check which loop is involved. Like in this patient, the inspiratory loop is getting affected, whereas the expiratory loop is normal. So a conclusion that we can make out of this history and this loop is that the patient has an inspiratory phase affected. Now, why we are checking which phase is affected? It is because different anatomical locations of the airway are affected differently to the phase of respiration affected. Like if the patient has a problem in the pharynx or supraglottis, then the inspiratory phase is affected. If the patient has a problem in subglottis, trachea or dextrothoracic airway, then the biphasic phase is affected, that is both inspiration and expiration are affected equally. Whereas if there is a problem in the intrathoracic airway, then usually the expiratory phase is affected. Now why different anatomical locations are acting differently to the phase? For this we need to know two things. One, about some basic physics laws, and two, about the normal respiratory cycle. So first the physics law, in which the first law is whenever the volume increases, the pressure decreases. This is the Boyle's law, which we used to study in our 11th 12th classes. And second is that the air always moves from an area of high pressure to the area of low pressure. Now these concepts we'll be using in how the respiration occurs. So what happens in normal respiratory cycle? Initially there is an active inspiration in which the muscles are being involved, followed by there is a passive expiration. So how does it get initiated? There is a pre-Bodzinger complex and a dorsal respiratory group present in the medulla, which stimulates the intercostal muscles as well as the diaphragm. So what will happen is, due to the contraction of intercostal muscles, the chest wall will move out, and due to contraction of the diaphragm will move down, and this intrathoracic volume will increase. So as this intrathoracic volume increases, the pressure will decrease and it will become more negative. So the more negative pressure present in this intrathoracic cage will pull out the lung. So there will be an outward pull on this airway, like this. As this airway gets pulled outward, the volume of this airway will increase, so the pressure in this airway will decrease. Let's say the atmospheric pressure is 0, then the pressure in this airway will become -1. And this airway, that is the airway within the lung, is connected upward to the trachea, to the larynx, to the supraglottis, to the pharynx and to the nose. The pressure in whole of the tract will become -1. And the atmospheric pressure is 0, so now a pressure gradient has been created between the atmosphere and the airway tract, so the air will move from the area of high pressure to the area of low pressure. This is how the air moves in during inspiration. The intercostal muscles will come out, the diaphragm will go down, the airway will be pulled out, decreasing the pressure, creating a pressure gradient, and thus air going from the area of high pressure to the area of low pressure. This is what happens on inspiration. Now as the air comes in, the vagus nerve will get stimulated when the enough volume of the airway becomes. So the increased stimulation of the vagus will occur, and this will inhibit the DRG, and now there will no stimulation of the muscles. So as the muscles are not getting stimulated, the chest wall will come in, the diaphragm will come in. Now this intrathoracic volume will decrease, so the intrathoracic pressure increase, pushing the lung inward. As the lung will be pulled inward, the volume of the airway will decrease, increasing the pressure. Increasing the pressure to +1. Now the airway has a pressure of +1, whereas the atmospheric pressure is 0, so now the air will come out. So this is how a normal respiratory cycle occur. So this is the respiratory tract showing the different parts of the airway. This is the airway within the lung. This is the airway outside the lung, the extrathoracic airway, the bronchus, the trachea. This is the supraglottic part, the subglottic part, this is the pharynx part, and these are the nostril. So what is happening on inspiration is, a negative pressure is being created everywhere along this tract, and whereas the pressure outside is 0, so the air will go in. During expiration there is a plus one pressure present in the airway, so the air will go out. So this is how it occurs. Now one important thing to know how different airways are being affected in different phases, you need to know the anatomy, because it is the anatomy that is making them differently act to the phases of respiration. Like the pharynx and the supraglottis, the airways are made by the membranes, whereas the subglottis and the extrathoracic airway, these airways are surrounded by the cartilages, whereas the intrathoracic airway is surrounded by the lung tissue. So what will happen is, on inspiration, in the supraglottic and the pharynx, which is covered by the membrane, when the inspiration occurs, there will be negative pressure present within the lumen. Now this negative minus one pressure will pull in the membrane. So as the membranes are pulled in during inspiration, there will be less caliber of the airway during inspiration. So there will be more turbulence during inspiration in supraglottis. Whereas in the subglottis and extrathoracic, there is cricoid cartilage present in the subglottis, whereas there is tracheal cartilage present in the extrathoracic part. So on inspiration and expiration, again there will be negative pressure created, but due to the hard cartilage present around them, they will not be able to pull the airway in. So the caliber will remain same both during inspiration as well during expiration, because there are hard cartilage present. So the turbulence will be same in both inspiration and expiration in subglottis and the extrathoracic airway. But wherever what happens in the intrathoracic airway, the airway is surrounded by lung tissue. And we have seen that on inspiration, the chest wall goes out, pulls the lung out, pulling the airway out. So on inspiration, the airway caliber is increasing of the intrathoracic airway. Whereas on expiration, there is a push present, which decreases the caliber, so decreasing the lumen. So there will be more turbulence present on expiration. So hope you have understood that the anatomy of the different areas of the respiratory tract are different, and this is why they are acting differently due to drug expiration. So based on the above concepts, now I'll be looking at interpretation of each of the flow volume curve. So the first step is always to check which phase is involved. Like in the first one, the inspiratory phase is involved, in the second one expiratory, in the third both inspiratory and expiratory, and in the fourth also both inspiratory and expiratory. Now in this, we know that the inspiratory is affected in supraglottis and pharynx, and we know that both of these are extrathoracic. And now, as the obstruction is present in on inspiration only and not on expiration, this is called as variable type of obstruction. If it is present both on inspiration and expiration, then we call it as fixed. So this type of loop in which the inspiratory phase is affected, this is found in extrathoracic variable. The second one, the expiratory, we know that the expiratory phase is affected in the intrathoracic airway, and we know from this that the only expiratory phase is involved, so it will be variable. So this second loop is found in intrathoracic variable. Now the third and the fourth loop, in both of these loop, both inspiratory and expiratory phase is involved, but they are different. In the third loop, the slopes are similar to the normal loops, only is that the loops have been shrinked. So this occurs in case of restrictive lung diseases, like the interstitial lung diseases. What happened in the interstitial lung diseases? This is the lung, this is the airway, and there is increased fibrosis of the interstitial tissue. So now what will happen is, on inspiration, when the chest wall goes out, pulling the lung out, the airway will open, but it will open less because there is fibrosis present. Similarly, on expiration, the airway will collapse, but the collapse will be less as compared to normal because of fibrosis. So on inspiration, there is less expansion, and on expiration there is less collapse. So this is why this type of pattern is present in restrictive lung disease. Whereas in the fourth type of loop, again both inspiration and expiration is affected, and the slopes are different from the normal loops. So this will occur in conditions where both inspiration and expiration affected, which we studied as subglottis, the trachea, and the extrathoracic airway. And we know that all of these are extrathoracic, and both inspiratory and expiratory phase are involved, so it is fixed. So this type of loop is present in extrathoracic fixed type of obstruction, which can also be called as upper airway fixed type of obstruction. So with this, we have understood which flow volume curve is present in which condition. Now coming back to the question, we had a patient with an inspiratory stridor with inspiratory lobe being affected. So we have come to know that either the pharynx is involved or the supraglottis is involved. Now, based on history, the oral cavity and the oropharynx examination was normal. So the probably the pharynx is ruled out. Now in supraglottis, there can be two causes. Either there can be pathology within the supraglottis or there can be pathology in the hypopharynx present posteriorly, which may be compressing the supraglottis. But as no dysphagia is present, the hypopharyngeal pathology is ruled out. So probably there is a pathology within the supraglottis. Now the pathology could have been ineffective, but as there is no fever present, it is less likely. Like in young children, epiglottitis can occur, which can present with inspiratory stridor. But here in this case, both the age doesn't correlate, and also there is no fever present, so it is less likely. And patient being a chronic smoker, this might be case of a CA larynx, and the patient might have come due to acute dyspnea because of hemorrhage into the tumor. So in this case, we will go for the direct laryngoscopy, which we could not earlier do in the emergency, and look for the pathology.